for your giving. Thank you for your support. And just be encouraged. God is a good God and God is faithful to his word. We thank God for our pastor as he comes to deliver the word. Hallelujah. Thank God for the message that's been given us to carry us. For God has us for.
The thing I want to share first is what Christ has become, what Christ has done for us is very, very important, what Christ has done. In other words, the redemptive work that Christ has done is something that all of us really need to get a revelation of. And it's not going to come easy. It's going to come through having the right attitude. It's going to come through diligence. It's going to come through consistently seeking the revelation and the faith that was once delivered to the saints. But what Christ has become and who we are as a result of Christ's redemptive work is probably the portion of the Word of God that we will draw more from in terms of us of getting us established in the Word of God. And what we basically have shared the last few weeks is that the thing that Christ has done can be summarized in 2 Peter 1, 3, and 4, and 1 Corinthians 1, 30. Basically, all of the blessings, the promises, the provisions that Christ has established, I know we have to get a revelation of it. It's going to come through prayer. It's going to come through diligence. It's going to come through being doers of the Word of God. It's going to come through being committed. But I believe that the potentials that the believers have, amen, is phenomenal. The potential that we have in Christ is phenomenal. Now we get to a comfortable point where we will bring this down to where the rubber meets the road and make this reality and things that we have to do, the action that we have to take. And today I'm going to focus more on the doers of the Word of God in order to bring into fruition the things that God has clearly, amen, provided for us through His redemptive work. You know, I just love to read about the things that Christ has already done through us through the sacrifice that He has made. Makes my heart really, really glad. And I'm endeavoring to present this in a way where you can equally share the joy and experience the rejoicing that every believer should have as a result of knowing who they are in Christ. These scriptures, 2 Peter 1:3-4, 2 Peter 1:3-4, I want you to take these scriptures very serious today. It says this, according as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Then it goes down and tells the things that we have to add, things that we have to do. In other words, what we have to do in response to the things that Christ has already provided for us. Amen. Now, if you wanted to put all of the blessings and provisions that Christ has made and all of them that He died for, and the Bible says that we've been bought with a price, amen, bought with a great price, and we are to glorify the Father, which is in heaven. We're to glorify God in our body, our spirits, which belong to God. So our job is to receive the Word of God with gladness, amen, and be joyful and rejoice in the provisions and blessings that God has made. When you become aware of what Christ has done, that does set the stage for you to really begin to rejoice. We don't want to take the things of God so casually, because if we take them that way, they'll never profit us and they'll never do us any good. We've got to be extremely happy for the provisions that Christ has made. For instance, like, you can actually receive a lot more even from your spouse, your children, or whoever you are, you know, you are accustomed to relating to by showing kindness, showing appreciation, and showing a spirit of appreciation. You can actually receive more. I know that sometimes my wife will be mad at me. She say, here's a thank you. And she always will be mad at me. She say, what you going to say? Sometimes she does some wonderful things. I mean, most times, all the time, she does some wonderful things. But I know that she always responds really in a different manner when I really I express the appreciation and express gratitude towards the things that she does. Amen. So I think that's a good lesson for all of us to learn. We need to learn how to just what? Be thankful. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Amen. Praise God. So this scripture kind of sums it all up. So it says that according to his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Okay, now all of these provisions and blessings that Christ has provided us, the scripture says all of these promises in him are yea and amen. And they're so numerous, they're so diverse, his grace is so abundant until there's no way we can even begin to calculate or even to know or to ascertain the extent of the blessings that God has provided for us. The scripture says this, that eye hasn't seen it, neither ear has heard it, neither has it been revealed to the heart of men, the things that God has what? Prepared for them that what? But he hath revealed them by his what? Spirit. He is revealing them through his Spirit. Amen. It takes revelation, it takes prayer, it takes diligence, it takes being a doer, it takes being obedient and compliant with the word of God in order for these blessings and the extent of these blessings that God has provided us will come into fruition and will begin to work in our lives. And I'm willing to pay the price. How many can say amen? Amen. There's a whole lot more we can do, in other words, to be more enriched. Now the scripture says it very good in verse 3. It's going to come to the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. See, the glory that we initially started out with as God's creation, the Bible says, what is man that, this is Psalms 8:1, you can compare that. Last week, as we gave you the scripture, we compared 1 Corinthians, I'm sorry, we compared, it was Psalms 8 with Hebrews, I believe, 1. Both of them spoke about what is man, that thou art mindful of him, the son of man, that thou visited him. Thou hast crowned him with glory and honor. Everybody that God created, amen, praise God, that has been recreated has been crowned with glory and honor. The initial man, Adam, was crowned with what? Glory and honor. And honor. When he fell, then the glory and the honor, the dominion, and all of the blessings and benefits and provisions that God has had made for him, amen, fell into the hand of Satan. But Jesus has paid the price to recapture, to recover, and to regain, amen, all that has been lost through Adam. So the glory has been restored. Is that right? Amen. The glory has been restored. And the scripture says here in verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So the provisions that was lost through Adam has been recaptured or restored, amen, through the sacrificial work of Jesus. Amen. The price that Jesus paid for us. I'm going to turn back to Hebrews 1 and let you look at that scripture again, because that's going to be a key scripture that shows you that you are back in place, the position that you fell from, the provisions and blessings and all of those rights and privileges that Adam, amen, deprived us of, those things have been restored through Christ. Now, when we speak about new creation realities, it doesn't really mean, it doesn't register with most believers, because most times it takes revelation knowledge, it takes being a doer of the word, it takes what, prayer, it takes the eyes of your understanding, being what, enlightened, that you might know the hope of his calling. See, revelation knowledge, natural things, even spiritual things are what? Spiritually what? Discerned. There's a price you have to pay. There, right? There's a sacrifice you have to make. Amen. There's a commitment that you must, amen, commit to in order to make what? Spiritual realities, amen, reality in your life. Now, I'm turning to Hebrews. Started there, told you about it, but didn't get there, but I am there now. Chapter 2. It says, verse 6. Chapter 2, Hebrews, chapter 2. But one in a certain place testifies, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visited him? This is the exact same thing found in Psalms 8, 1 through 8 and 9. Thou makest him a little lower than the angels. Thou crownest him with glory and honor. So we're saying that the glory and the honor that we started out with as God's creation, we were the crown of God's creation. Man was made in the image and likeness of God, right? Yes. As close to God as it was humanly possible for him to make him. Because God made man for a particular purpose to what? Amen. To reveal or to manifest his character, his nature. And there are many reasons why man was created. But why do we have children? Usually to what? To enjoy. For our pleasure, to fellowship with, to relate to have somebody to what? Boss, I mean, to whip and to discipline. Amen. But there is fulfillment in children, is that right?
Yes.
If they are trained right, if they get the right stuff in them. There is a real what? Fulfillment in what? In children. I mean, you can just go down the list. Well, for us as God's creation, those things included things like, I wrote these down, they were made in God's image for his pleasure, for fellowship. I think if you want to sum it all up, amen, we were made to praise and to glorify and to magnify God.
Amen.
Amen. The only way people are going to really know God, many times, if they haven't experienced the reality of him, is going to be through the believer. So we are the representatives. Scripture says we are laborers together with him. We are God's ambassadors. We are the ones that represent God and the one that project what God is like, his character, his nature, his goodness, his love, his mercy, his compassion. Amen. And his, the whole gamut of attributes that relate to God, we are the one to project that because the scripture says we are the lights of the world. Is that right? Amen. We are the light of the world, and if men are going to see Christ, they have to see him reflected through us. So we represent God. We carry out his will. Amen. We make his way known. We are stewards of the earth. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. So we are created, amen, to praise and to glorify and to magnify God. So the Bible says that our primary role as believers is to be very excited, to be very, amen, expressive about our relationship to God in terms of praising him, rejoicing him, rejoicing in him, and actually giving him the glory that's due him. So fellowship is very, very important with God. And how many know that through what Christ has done, we've been called back into fellowship? Amen. We have the right to enter into God's presence, amen, without a sense of sin, without a sense of guilt, and without a sense of condemnation. The Bible says there is therefore what now? No condemnation. So Christ brought us back into fellowship. Christ established our dominion. Amen. Now we are rulers. We started out as rulers. We started out with dominion over all of the works of God's hand. And now that, amen, that honor, that glory, and all of those provisions that God gave men initially has been put back into place. And that's what we're reading about right here. Thou made him a little lower than the angels. Thou crownest him with glory and honor, and didst set every over the works, him over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under subjection under his feet, in subjection. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. So that's the thing that brought us back into fellowship. That's the thing that reconciled us. That's the thing that redeemed us. That's the thing that brought us back into right standing with God. Amen. When Adam sinned, the whole creation began to experience what? Spiritual death. Death reigned from Adam until Christ. So now Jesus was crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him for whom all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. When Jesus' sufferings were culminated, when he had finished, when he had perfected, amen, us forever, amen, when he had completed the sufferings that God ordained for him to go through, for our redemption to become reality, that was the thing that caused, amen, many sons to come back into glory. In other words, that position of honor, position of power, that position where man given all things, that's the way it started out. All things were under man's feet when it started out. And now, under the new creation, amen, all of those things have been restored. But it took the death. Scripture says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. He was made a curse for us. Amen. Praise God. So Jesus has, what, paid the price. He's laid down his life. He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. Everybody said, we are made the righteousness of God. Yeah. Righteousness of God simply means that we have been restored back to that original position that we started out, the position of glory, the position of honor, where we had absolutely dominion. My God. Amen. Praise. Unlimited fellowship in God's presence. Amen. All things belong to us because the scripture says everything that God made, he made it in order to meet the needs of the crown of creation, which was man. So the scripture says these things, amen, concerning, amen, the results of all that Christ has made and done for us. Amen. 1 Corinthians 1:30, it says it real good. 1 Corinthians 1:30. It says that, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus. How many believe that you are in Christ?
Amen.
Amen. In scripture, over 130 times, it reminds us that we are in Christ.
Yes.
If any man be in Christ, he's a new what? Creature. Old things are passed away, and all things have become what? New. So our position have changed. Amen. God has delivered us from the power of darkness under Satan's dominion, under his jurisdiction, under his control. Alienated, that's when we were alienated and enemies in our minds about wicked works, the Bible says. But yet God has what? Reconciled us. Amen. Through, amen, the body of his flesh. Amen. Jesus has paid an offer price. How many, amen, can visualize the pain and the suffering that Jesus had to go through? Now just think of one person that dies now without Christ, how they have to experience eternal torment, amen, amen, throughout eternity. A jillion years, they have to experience, they're paying for what? Their sin, rejecting Christ. But Jesus has what? Suffered for every person's, amen, what? Sin. So Jesus did all of that suffering that would take jillions of years if he were to atone for every person individually. It would take jillions of years for him to what? He let Christ in the body of his flesh. So you don't really understand what Jesus went through those 3 days and three nights when he what? He bore our sin, when he became sin for us. I don't think anybody had any inkling as to the extent that Jesus had to suffer, amen, to put us in the position and to restore us back to the place where we enjoy now. And how can we sit up in here and not give glory to God? Bible says we were bought with a what? Price. Glorify God in your body. Boy, it's hard to have almost pay somebody to glorify God. That's the reason the Bible says that, amen, the extent of the promises and provisions, to really appreciate it, you're going to have to get what? A knowledge of it. That's what Pastor's trying to do. I'm going to bring it on down by the revolutionary road from things you got to do, practical stuff. You got to do that. You need to be doing. I ain't going to say you're not doing. But the scripture says him, but of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. If you had to sum all of the things that we have talked about to this point up, that Christ has restored back to us, I would say Christ has become our wisdom.
Yeah.
Amen. Our wisdom is a big issue. Amen. Righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Now, righteousness by itself simply means the ability, amen, to function or to live in God's presence without the sense of inability, of sin, of unworthiness, without the sense of fear, without feeling second class or second grade. The same freedom that Jesus enjoyed with his Father when he was constantly in fellowship with him. Amen. That's the position that we have been restored back to. If you really want to get a good view of who you are in Christ, just look at the second Adam. Don't want to look at the first Adam. He had it, but blew it, right? Amen. But the second Adam didn't blow it. He did no sin. He was tempted in all points as we are, but the scripture says, yet without sin. Oh, I love it. Boy, when you can really understand what Jesus went through and how he stood against the devil, amen, and how he paid the price and made the sacrifice and the things that he did from the time that he became sin for us until the time that he rose again from the dead, amen, you would begin to what? Praise God, really begin to what? Magnify him and praise him. The Bible says that, amen, we ought to glorify him in our what? Spirit and in our bodies, which what? Belongs to him. Because he's the one that what? Redeemed us from the curse. He's the one that brought us back. And it was a what? High price. Amen. Pray. It was a high price that he paid. How many would have loved to pay the price that Jesus paid? And some of y'all don't even want to pay the little price you pay. I mean, you do it without a meal, come to church, make a sacrifice. Some of us don't even want to do that a little bit. Amen. Praise God. But even righteousness, right standing with God, is a big issue, because right standing means the position that we started out with as a created being through Adam. That position has been what? Restored back. With that position comes this. Amen. You become a ruler. Scripture says, made of heaven, dominion. Whoo, glory. Amen. How many believe we got dominion? Oh, amen. How many believe that the dominion has been restored? Amen. So y'all don't even say amen, because you appreciate what dominion. Dominion means what? Rulership. You got control. You got power and authority. Over what? One thing you got over your flesh, whether you know it or not. You just don't exert it many times. You just don't what? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Use what you got, but you got dominion over sin.
Amen.
How many are glad you don't have to sin every day like you used to sin?
Amen.
Bible says, whosoever is born of God does not what? Habitually commit sin. I'm glad that I'm free from sin. Hallelujah. Because he was scared living in sin. The Bible says the way of a transgressor is what? Hard. I used to have a problem every night when I went to bed because I thought something would happen to me before I got saved.
Come on.
None of y'all had that problem.
Amen. Praise God. You thought God was going to what? Get back at you, judge you for all of the wickedness and sin that you were what, committed. How many ran from God for a long time? Amen. Solomon, Brother Joy. God bless you. My last confession is good for Sister Lydia. All right.
Amen.
Hallelujah. How many can say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
So we have been delivered from the power of darkness. Everybody just say, I'm delivered from the power of darkness. The power of the flesh. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Flesh shall not have what? Dominion over me? Amen. We are not debtors to the flesh to live after the flesh, right?
Amen.
Put on the Lord Jesus and have make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. So the flesh is the thing that's going to what? Lead to corruption. It's going to lead to death. They're right. It's going to lead to being lost. But, amen, those that are of Christ, amen, they have crucified the, amen, the flesh with all of the lust thereof. Whether you believe it or not, you don't have to give in to your flesh when your flesh tells you to do something contrary to the word of God.
Amen.
You don't have to give in to the flesh.
That's right.
Is that right? You don't have to obey it. If you knew you had power and authority over your flesh,
yes,
you can what? Speak to your flesh because your flesh understands the words that you speak.
Amen. That's right.
That's the difference between, that's the reason why, amen, we're superior to angels because angels, amen, they can't choose their words. Amen. You have to what? Speak the word and they have to what? Carry out your command.
That's right.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
But we have power of what? To rule through our words. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Our words have what? Power, especially if we've been born again and if we're operating in the realm of faith. We are operating on a level where we can become what? Rulers over God's what? Creation. Everything that God has created can be ruled with what? Words coming out of the mouth of a person,
right,
amen, that got faith in God.
Amen.
How many can say amen?
Amen?
See, if y'all really love that, the scripture says this, amen, blessed is he that feareth the Lord and delighteth greatly in his commandments. amen, that we're talking about, I'm just kind of summing them up now. He abounded toward us in all wisdom.
Yes.
In the, amen. Ephesians 1, in all wisdom. He has abounded. In other words, he has released. I mean, I know we got to what? Get into the Word of God. We got to what? Be faithful unto death. There's some things that we got to do, right? We got to learn how to what? Be thankful. We got to come to Sunday school, Bible study, read your Bible. Amen. I want to admonish you today to really get back to you to the Word of God. Amen. Start in the New Testament. Just read it. Just start reading. Because I think that if we can just take another look at the Word of God and really begin to what? Get back to the Word. Sometimes as a pastor, you just have to admonish people to start what? Read your Bible again. Amen. Praise God. Pull out your Bible. Amen. Try to read the whole book of Matthew. Just go through the Word and just begin to read the Bible again, because we need to what? Amen, praise God. Come up to a different level in getting the understanding and the revelation of what Christ has done for us. So we need to read the Gospels. We need to read the book of Matthew. Don't might as well say amen. And we need to read the epistles, because in the epistles you will get a revelation of who you are in Christ. And you need to just stick with every time anything that pertains to what? Who you are in Christ.
Yes.
As he is, so are we. You know, all of these scriptures I'm reading from now, amen, these scriptures are in the epistles. He's abounding toward us in all wisdom. Amen. Praise God. And as you begin to praise him and magnify him and to thank him for releasing that wisdom is available, but the scripture says it comes through what? Knowledge. Comes through knowledge of him that has called us from what? Glory to virgin. You got to get a revelation. And the Bible says you got to pray that the eyes of your understanding might be what? Enlightened. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. The scripture says, amen, praise God, that you might know. How many can say amen? You might know the hope of his calling.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. The riches of the glory of the inheritance that's in the saints. Church. And we need to what? Stay in the Word of God.
Yes.
Is that right?
Amen.
Oh, my Lord.
All right. All right.
Hey.
Well, you don't think you're
you can't work it. If you don't know, they ain't gonna know.
That's right.
If you don't have a fear of God in your life,
that's right.
If you don't delight greatly in the law of the Lord,
that's right.
Amen. How can the blind lead the blind?
Yeah. That's right.
Amen. Praise God. We need to be doing something to get ourselves established. We don't know how long, amen, every nation like America, when they got to the degree of corruption that America is, most of them did not last that long. Bible says righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to what? Any people. Amen. Praise God. It's not time to be getting further from God, getting more slack, getting more relaxed. It's time to what? Draw near. Oh, Lord. How many can say amen? The commandments of the Lord appear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and doing forever. Yes. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired of they than gold, yea, than much gold, fine gold, also sweeter than honey and the honeycomb. Amen. Ooh, the word just got to get be that good to us.
Yeah.
More than gold. How many want money? How many need some more money?
Yeah.
How many want some money? How many want more word?
Yeah.
All right. All right, moreover, by them is that servant one, and keeping them there's a great reward. All right, in keeping them there's a what?
Great.
All right, I'm just about done because the time is up. But I just want to run this by you. Ephesians 1:8, abound it toward us in all wisdom. So that means that all what you need is available. You got to pay the price. You got to get down to the brass tacks and begin to make a commitment. And begin to deny your flesh. Take authority so that God can be all in all in you. Whatever you need him to be, praise God. That's what, praise God, he can become in you. But there's a price you have to pay. I'm out just about you, sister. That in everything, you are enriched by him. In everything.
Amen.
Ye are enriched in him in all utterance. And all knowledge. 1 Corinthians 1:5. That's already been provided. If you get into the word, if you pray that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened, if you take your place in God and do what God says do and begin to rejoice, amen, praise God, these things will become reality because the scripture says the provisions have already been made. You're already enriched by him. How do you need to be enriched? Whatever area of your life, in all utterance and in all knowledge. All right.
Amen.
All right. Therefore, let no man glory in man, for all things are yours. How many can say all things are mine?
All
things are yours. I mean, all that was lost in Adam has been what? Regained. That's the reason why Jesus died. And ye are complete in him, which is ahead of all principality and power. Colossians 2:10. Ye are complete. Tell somebody ye are complete. Just tell somebody you're complete. Amen. You've been perfectly perfected. Everything that you will ever need is already in you.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost is in you. How many can say amen? Because the scripture says if we pray that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, then we'll know the hope of our call. We'll know the riches. Watch this right here. Watch this. This is Ephesians 1, 16, 17, 18, 19. It said, you will know the riches of the glory of the inheritance which is in the saints. Ooh, the glory of the riches of the inheritance. How many believe that you have received an inheritance? Wait a minute. It's spiritually and what? Naturally. Transformation that we need to experience. Amen. By start taking action on your own. Just get your Bible out. Wipe the dust off. I know some of y'all get bored sitting down trying to read 30 minutes or 15 minutes. Man's the easiest thing to do. But you gotta what? You gotta get back in the Word of God, right? All right. Y'all have. All right. As He is, so are we in this world. All right, I'm done.
Praise
my dear friends, help me out. All right, well, the scripture makes it plain. He says that whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and be not a forgetful hearer, amen, but a what? Doer of the work, that man shall be what? Blessed in all of his deeds. The man that delighteth greatly in the word of God, the Bible says, wealth and riches shall be in his house, right? And the generation of the upright, I don't know whether y'all are raising an upright generation of the house. I hope you ain't raising a whole lot of hoodlums. A whole lot of pornography, watches, and getting sons and daughters. If you just let them go on their own, follow the line of least resistance, make everybody crooked.
That's right.
All right. You'll make a river crooked. Right. Following the line of least resistance. Amen. Praise God. So we got to get in the Word, because that's the only restraint, that's the only thing that can what? Keep us. Amen. Praise God. In a realm where we can fear God and we can really begin to enjoy the blessings and the provision that Christ has made for us. Alright, I just want to see everybody. Amen. I'm going to be on the floor. I kind of fell out of the loop for about 6 minutes. I kind of felt lost when I got back. I said, man, I'm alive.